Good morning. Happy Easter. Do you ever turn to your neighbors? Tell them happy Easter. Tell them you're happy they're here. You guys are the late rising crowd, man. We were slamming jam. You guys got the better seating situation. You know, got people right on top of you on this go round. So, hey, if we have not met, my name is Brad. It's an honor to have you here with us today. I get to serve as an e-teaching pastor here at One Missoula Church, which means I get to do this a lot of the time and get to work with people and figuring out how the Bible works into their lives. And man, we were expecting a whole lot of you guests today. So if you're new here, we did a lot of prep this past week. So even we went as far as connecting our sewer line to the city sewer line. So that's how much we just love and care about you. Did anybody see all the construction going on out in the parking lot this past week? Yeah, I know you saw it. You know how I know? Because you were texting me, right? I mean, there was so much chatter this week. I was getting so many emails, like, do you see what's happening in the parking lot? I was like, no, what is it, right? And it's like, oh, it's totally caught off guard. Even our neighbors were getting involved in the action, right? They're messaging us on Facebook, like, hey, what's going on? Like, we have one woman that she was asking, of course, like, hey, are you guys doing a renovation? What's going on? And my wife got to it before I could get to it, because I wanted to be like, man, we got to put the bodies somewhere, right? You know? Like, a lot of churches have cemeteries, and we just wanted to see what all the hype was about, right? So, we were there. I had a good friend. It was what we're doing is just getting compliance with the city, and man, we couldn't think of a better time than Easter week, right, to get that construction done. So, we did that. It came down to wire finish. It was 5 o'clock on Friday afternoon, and the guys that were out here working were absolute heroes. They weren't done because the project was fighting back, right? They planned for the project to fight back. It was still fighting back, but they're, like, powering through. And they're like, hey, man, we got this going on over here. And so we're out there, like, strategizing because those of you that drove by on Friday at, like, lunchtime, there was a mountain. I mean, a mountain burnt. And so these guys, these absolute wonderful heroes, go, hey, we'll just fill everything back in. We'll dig it back out on Monday. They created, a half day's worth of work in order for you to come and be here. And I found out they were supposed to wrap up at 5, and about 7 p.m., so 2 hours later, the main guy, the lead guy, John, I find out he has a dinner reservation for his wife's 30th birthday at 7:30, like 30 minutes late. Like, the dude stayed so that we could have this incredible time here together, and so my sincere desire is that today is an incredible day. So I know there's a lot going on. I was even getting texts from my pastor buddies around town, like they're watching, you know, pastors from other churches, and they're texting and emailing, and hey, what's going on? You guys got a project? You know, just kind of checking in. I had one guy that it was like 3 o'clock Friday afternoon. This is one of my buddies. He's like, hey, man, where's your parking lot? Right? And I'm like, you're so funny. I'm a slash of tires. Right? So we're just sitting there. Everybody's having a good time with it, but we got it done, man. I hope it's an incredible day. I sincerely hope that 5 years from now, you can look back on Easter 2023 and you can go, man, that was an incredible day. A pivot happened in my life. Right? There was this big turnaround in Easter, man. I went to church and I got up in my eyes and I saw things. I heard things just ways that I didn't see or hear them before, and it just clicked. It made sense. And I wanted what God wanted for me. I'll tell you what I've been praying for you all week long is that God would develop a craving in you for His absolute best, and that you just wouldn't settle for anything. And so that's what we're trying to accomplish today. Right? And the idea today is that if the tomb is empty, right? Easter, if Easter is the reality, and it's the reality, if the tomb is empty, then anything is possible. And I'm saying that, and I know that you might be in some really, really desperate situations right now. I may not know what's going on, but let me see if I can kind of put together maybe a little bit of what you're like. Okay? Like, maybe this is something that you've dealt with. I bet at some point in your life, in your past, right, you wanted to be a part of something great. Probably wanted to be part of something significant or beautiful or powerful, right? Maybe it was a relationship. Maybe it was a career or a cause, some sort of mission that you wanted to give yourself to. Right? You wanted to look at life and you're like, man, I want to have great relationships. I want to be, have peace financially. I want to kind of live where I want. I want to be able to have people understand me. I want to be able to live in an environment that's not contentious and hostile all the time. You're like, man, I want life to look like something great and beautiful. And then what happened? Life happened, right? Then life happens, and it happens to all of us, and we get
can't we get jaded? And so now, like, you're sitting here, it's Easter Sunday 2023, and you're like, man, I really wanted life to be this, but it's kind of here. And if I were to ask you to describe your life, you might say, meh, meh. Everybody say, meh, meh, right? You see the meh emoji, right? Like, that's how you might, like, describe your life. Others in here, it's way worse than that, right? You're way farther down, you're looking up at meh. Things have gone so sideways in relationships, or health, or finance, or academics, or vocation, or whatever, right? The life has gone so sideways in life that you are now dealing with not just disillusionment, right? Not just disappointment, but maybe desperation, maybe despair. And what I want you to hear on Easter Sunday of 2023 is that if the tomb is empty, then anything is possible. Anything is possible. I don't mean everything's going to go right. I mean God can get involved and can redeem things and start piecing things back together in His way, right? Now, I want you to see something. In Easter, Easter doesn't just take place in a vacuum. The resurrection of Jesus Christ that we celebrate at Easter doesn't take place in a vacuum, okay? Jesus Christ's victory, and this is the first point in your notes. You should have given a handout, by the way, when you came in. It's got a connect card where you can write questions and turn those into the offering boxes afterwards. Right, or prayer requests, or whatever. It's a great way to engage with us. So here's the first point in your handout was this, is that Jesus Christ's victory over the grave was good news that invaded desperate spaces. All right, it wasn't like Jesus like died and then he rose again, and it was just right kind of in the middle of like puppy dogs and rainbows, like everything was great. It was in a really bad situation. And I want to zero in on the gospel story, the resurrection story, in the Gospel of Luke. And I want to give you just a little bit of setup and try to get into the headspace that Jesus' contemporaries were dealing with, right? The people that were watching and seeing his earthly ministry almost 2,000 years ago. And we're going to look at a guy by the name of Joseph of Arimathea. Now, you may not know this guy. That's okay. What you need to know is he is a Jew. In the Old Testament, God calls the Jews to be his people, and he gives the Jews land. And Joseph of Arimathea is a Jew, and he's a good Jew. He's a faithful Jew. He sits on this council, and the council's kind of like, they're like spiritual and political leaders, okay? And so he's on this council, and this council is the group of people who were the ones that decided to have Jesus Christ turned over to the Romans to be crucified. I want you to know something. This is a guy, he's faithful to God. He's a kind of a Bible scholar to sit on this council. He's got all these sorts of things, and he desires good things of God. And he's looking at Jesus, and Jesus is like, man, is this guy the Messiah? Or Joseph is like, man, is Jesus the Messiah? Is he possibly the solution to what we've got going on? Because what he's got going on is this. He's in a real political, military oppression situation. See, the Romans, back in the day, they had invaded the Jews, the land of the Jews, right? God's promised people. And they were there with swords and catapults and horses and real military might, like you've probably seen in the movies, like Gladiator. I mean, real warriors. And what they would do is they'd invade these lands, and they invaded Israel and Judea. And so they're, like, taking over, and they're using their military might in order to exact lots of taxes. And so they'd get money from the people, and they would take that money, and they would fund more military might to further oppress. Okay? That's the situation that Joseph is in. He's also in this situation where there's a whole lot of spiritual and moral bankruptcy going on. And so he's just waiting, right? And he's waiting for the promised Messiah that's been promised throughout the whole Old Testament, right? And so he's sitting here, and he's like, man, we need a Savior King. He's going to put things back together politically. He's going to put things back together geographically. Give us our land back. He's going to put things back together spiritually. He is going to be the solution. So that's where Joseph of Arimathea is. He's like, man, is this Jesus guy it? Is he there? Let's pick up in Luke chapter 23, verse 50. It said, there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea. He was a member of the council, a good and righteous man who had not consented to their decision and action, and he was looking for the kingdom of God. So, okay, so you've got this guy, and he's this, like, religious, spiritual leader, and he's looking for the kingdom of God. And I underline that in your notes, because here's the deal. So are you. So am I. He's looking at Jesus, and he's saying, man, I see that, I hear the teaching. I see the miracles. This Jesus character is driving out demons, right? He's casting demons out of people. He has this kind of power and ability. Is this our guy? Because he wants the kingdom of God. When you hear a story like what Harrison just shared with us about that 14-year-old boy dying from leukemia, and you're like, this is not right. It's not right. saints, when you look at man, people, religious leaders or political leaders or leaders of any stripe, business leaders, using their power in order to take from other people, and you're like, that's not right. I wish people who had power would use it for the good of others. That's you craving the kingdom of God. When you see death or disease or injustice or corruption or whatever, right, when you see these things and you're like, that's not right, it needs to be right, it should be right, and you're angry about it or you're frustrated, you're disappointed, right, when you're sitting there and you go, God, why, that is you craving the kingdom of God. That's what you're after. And some of you have met, and maybe been far from church for a long time, maybe got burned by church or whatever, you're running around, and can I tell you something? You're going to try to fill that craving with all the things that the world has to offer you, and it's not going to do it. It's not going to deliver on the promises. So Joseph of Arimathea, man, he's looking for the kingdom of God, and he thinks, man, maybe it's Jesus. And then Jesus is dead. All these hopes, all these dreams and desires, and then Jesus is just dead. And look at what he does. So he's going to go, this man, Arimathea, he went to Pilate. He's the Roman governor who's in charge. And he asked for the body of Jesus because Jesus was just crucified. He just died on a cross for the sins of the world, right? And so Joseph of Arimathea, he goes and asks for the body, the physical body of Jesus, where he had placed his hope in this man. And then he took it down and wrapped it in a linen shroud and laid him in a tomb cut in stone, where no one had ever yet been laid. Now, I want you to just kind of get this. This is physically, actually, historically happening. But it's a beautiful picture of what so many of us have had to do, right? You've got these desires, these cravings, this vision for life. And he's got all of his hope in Jesus. And he's literally having to take his hope and his dreams and physically bury the thing that he's after. He's after the kingdom of God. And this is it. This is the Messiah. No, it's not. Physically. Some of you have been in a situation, and all of us have been in a situation before, but some in different ways than others, right? You've had to bury a marriage. You've had to bury a business endeavor. You've had to bury a relationship of some sort. You've had to bury an academic ambition. You've had to bury a relationship with a sibling or a friend. You get what I'm saying? Like, life. Life happens. And life doesn't cooperate, and we sit and we find these desperate situations, and the good news of Easter is that Jesus' resurrection invades those desperate situations. In fact, that gets us to our point, so we can move, right? So there, that's where Joseph is, but he's in this desperate situation. We get to the good news of Easter. The good news of Easter is that if Jesus Christ's tomb is empty, anything is possible. Anything is possible. Now, let me be super clear. I don't want to say that if you come to Jesus and you receive Jesus, that everything's going to be amazing. Puppies and rainbows all the time, man. Money is just going to flow off of trees, and it's never going to snow in April again, right? Everything's going to be fantastic. That's not what I'm promising. Okay? That's not what the Bible promises. It says that even in the hardship and the difficulty, there can be meaning and purpose, and God can begin putting the pieces back together in your relationships and your finances and your health and in your endeavors with your vocation or academically or whatever. You will have this thing that is so very rare in our culture, and that is peace and purpose. Right? There can be hope in any and every situation. Let's read the account of the very first Easter. So Joseph of Arimathea, he had put all of his hope in Jesus. His disciples had also done the same. So Jesus has 12 disciples, a handful of ladies that were following him. One guy betrayed him, but he's got this group that were faithful and they were following Jesus. They were watching Jesus do these miracles and drive out demons and hear this incredible teaching, and they watched his sinless life, and they're like, this is our guy, this is the Messiah. So they're in the same situation. But Jesus is all of a sudden dead. He's just dead. He's buried. He's in a tomb. And they're sitting there going, oh, man, we just gave three and a half years of our lives to this guy. We're going to become a laughing stock, a mockery of our families and neighbors and friends, our nation, our enemies. Everybody's going to mock us. Not only that, but Jesus was crucified as a criminal, as a political criminal. And so his disciples are like, what's going to happen to us? So they're hiding. And they're in despair. And it's in that setting that you get Easter, the first Easter, almost 2,000 years ago. Luke 24, 1 through 9. It says, on the first day of the week at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. Now, this is the group of ladies. The guys are scattered. They're in hiding. right, whatever's going on, they're just not there. The ladies are going to care for Jesus' body. And so they're taking these spices that they had prepared, and they found this stone rolled away from the tomb. And when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Jesus put a tomb, they put a stone over it, it was rolled away, they go in, he's not there, his body's not there. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. These are angelic messengers here. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen." Amen. Happy Easter. This is the first Easter. Remember their state. Just think about their mental and emotional state. Like, all is lost. We're going to go trap his body. You know what? He wasn't the Messiah, but we loved him. We're going to take care of his body. And then all of a sudden, he's like, "Where is it?" Great news. He has overcome death. He has overcome the grave. And they're like, "What?" Could you imagine, like, your mental, like, that doesn't happen like that, right? So that's where they are. And they say, the angelic messengers say to these ladies, "Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise." The angelic messengers are pointing back to Jesus prophesying when he was alive. He didn't just say, "Hey, I'm going to die." He also said, "Here's how I'm going to die, and then I'm going to rise on the third day." And the angelic messengers are like, hey, remember? Remember what we were talking about? Like, you're here. You're looking for the living among the dead. He told you. You can trust his word. Now, this is one of the many ways that God gives us validation of the ministry and credibility and historicity of Jesus Christ. Okay? Now, what are they going to do? They're going to run, okay? And they're going to, they remembered his words. They're like, "Oh, yeah, he did say that." And then in verse 9, it says, "Returning from the tomb, they told all of these things to the 11 and all the rest." So they went and they found the men. They knew where they were. And they become the first evangelists. Now, real quick, super fast, tangent for you ladies that are investigating the claims of Christ. There's a whole lot of chatter in our world. Our world is hostile to God. Because if there's a God, then we're accountable. But I just want you to see something. The crowd that's hostile to God spends a lot of time with the propaganda of God is against women. God is against women. And the Bible's against women. And God is against women. I just want you to see something. I could point to all kinds of passages here. But the very first people to become human witnesses of the resurrection are women. And the very first evangelists are women. That's remarkable, right? And God is in control of everything. He's got a really, when you're God, you got a big chessboard, right? And so he's able to move whoever he wants. And he's like, "The ladies are going to do it," right? There's all kinds of cultural stuff in here. But I just want you to, the only reason I'm going on this tangent is for those of you that are investigating the claims of Christ, and you're checking out church, you're checking out the Bible, I just want to challenge you to challenge your sources, right? So if it's like something that's being said in academia, okay, or if it's something that's being said on the news, or it's all hyped up and hopped up on social media and so forth, challenge that, okay? Just challenge that. All right, tangent's over, okay? So you see Jesus rise from the grave. He defeats death. Now, that has obvious ramifications for all of us because we are all going to die. Obvious ramifications, okay? To give hope and to give life beyond the grave. Beautiful thing. But what about now? What about now? What about my relationships now before the grave? What about my finances now before the grave? What about my academic ambitions or my entrepreneurial endeavors or my vocational desires or whatever, right? Whatever the thing I want to be part of, making an impact in the world. And what about all of those things? What difference does Jesus Christ make here and now? How is it that anything is possible because the tomb is empty? Well, super simple, right? The Holy Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the grave enlightens and empowers anyone who is spiritually reborn through Jesus Christ. It's a lot of words. Let's hit it again. The Holy Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the grave. Pause. Okay. So Jesus was dead. He was in the tomb 2,000 years ago. Right? Dead. I don't mean like kind of sleep, kind of faint, but dead. And then the Spirit of God raises him from the grave. That same Spirit, the Bible teaches us, will enlighten, okay, I don't mean that in some mystical way, it just like leads us into truth, and then empowers, do me a favor, take your pens and circle that word, empowers, because that's what I want to talk about. It empowers anyone who is spiritually reborn through Jesus Christ. I want to look at the book of Romans. We're going to jump to Romans. Let me give you a little bit of setup right here. So Romans was written by a guy who was known earlier in the Bible, as a guy named Saul, and he hated people who were different. Saul was a Jew by nationality, and he was a Jew by religion, and he really couldn't stand people who were different from him. And so you know what God did with him? He reconciled him back to God first. So he calls Paul into ministry, repairs Paul's rejection of Christians, because Paul had rejected Jesus Christ. He hated Christians. He was persecuting Christians. Jesus appears to him. He's like, you, you're mine, and you're going to go on mission. And let me tell you who I'm going to send you to. I'm going to send you to all those people that you hate. Paul ends up going, living out the rest of his life for the glory of God and the good of the people that he used to hate. And I'm just saying this because for those of you that really want to see things healed and mended from all the hatred and division in our land, you really need to bring Jesus Christ into that situation. Okay, so Paul goes and he starts setting up churches. And one of the churches that he writes to is in the book of Romans, and he's writing to Christians, okay, people who have turned away from the kingdom of darkness and who have given their lives to Christ. And he says this, Romans 8, 9 through 11, he says, you, Christians in Rome, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if in fact the Spirit of God dwells in you. He's saying, hey, you have power, the power of God, because the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. And when I receive Jesus Christ, I have the Holy Spirit in me. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit that raised Jesus from the grave, is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. That was a lot of ways to just say, man, the same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is available to all who receive Jesus Christ. Repent, call on his name, declare allegiance to him. Right? Say, hey, I'm done with rebelling against God. Hey, I'm done with just really discarding and dismissing God. I'm going to turn my life to him and give my life to his mission. The Holy Spirit then dwells in us when we call upon the name of Christ, and it brings power into all those desperate situations. Right, so what does this look like here? So I thought this would be helpful for today. Okay? So I got something. I've actually got you in here, and here you are. Right? This is you. You're like, that doesn't look like me. No, it looks exactly like you. Right? So here you go. So I got this glove, and it's, I guess it's a pretty nice glove. It's got some leather, got some rubber, it's got some things like that. And so here's you. Right? This illustration is going to become so painfully obvious in about a minute that you're going to be like, okay. So here we go. Okay, so this is you, and you're in the world. You are living and existing in creation. And what the Bible tells all of us is that we are spiritually dead. Right? We're spiritually dead apart from Christ. And so what Paul just said in Romans was that when we receive Christ, we have his Spirit living inside of us. But without Christ, this is you. You're here and you're floppy. Okay? What is the problem with you being floppy? Well, the problem is there's other humans in the world. Right? There's other humans and people are going to come along like this guy. And they're going to have an effect on you. And you're going to make decisions based on how other people interact with you and how they treat you and so forth. Now, this guy, you can tell you, bright yellow, but this one's just flashy, okay? Sitting here nice and bright. This is a person that's like, maybe this is a person that you know, an in-law or friend or co-worker, and they're flashed out. They buy all the nice fancy stuff. They got the nice fancy house and the fancy this and the fancy that and all these sorts of things. And what's happening is they're interacting with you, and they're like, hey, I'm better than you. Hey, yeah, this is so much better. You wish you had what I have, man. Or maybe it's a marketer, right, who's coming along and they're going to say, okay, hey, listen, you don't have our product. Do you have any idea what your life is like without our product? And if you don't, it's your one and only life. Man, if you don't buy our thing, then your life, I mean, you're just going to go to the tomb without having the thing. And you're like, he's right, I'm going to buy the thing. Right, because that's how that works. And so people are like, man, I've got to buy all these things. So you start getting knocked around. You start making financial decisions that get you into a really bad financial spot. Because you don't have the ability to resist. Maybe it's an in-law, right? That's, if you're gonna marry my daughter, you better take care of her, okay? She needs a Porsche, and you bought her a Beamer. Right, that kind of thing. So just, all right. Okay, you get that guy. How about this one? Okay, you get other people that are in. You're not pretty enough. This one's pretty. You can't really see because it's, I think these are actual work gloves from our garage. Okay, so we've got like floral prints. This one's pretty. You're not any prettier, right? You're not as pretty as I am. You should look better, right? You should have this body. You should dress this way or shiny things. It's appearance, appearance, appearance. And what happens is we start getting into this situation when we're knocked about by other humans. Where it's like, oh, despair. Oh, self-pity. Oh, I don't have what the pretty person has. I need to have what the pretty person has. And then it's like, oh, I'm sad. And then who knows what we do in order to make up for that. And then there's this person. This person here, this one's rough, okay? This is an abrasive person. Okay, it's nice and sticky, it's like lifting boxes or whatever. But this person is selfish, and they're going to grate on you, and they're going to come along. Maybe it's a co-worker that always is jumping in and undermining your work or taking credit for you or leaving stuff around the office. Maybe it's an employer or an employee, and they're just doing these sorts of things, and you're just dominated by rage, and you're dominated by, I'm going to get that person, or maybe it's somebody, right, on like North Reserve at 5 p.m., right? And then it's more like this. And you're just enraged all the time, and then you're all wound up, and you get home, and you start yelling at people, and it starts messing with your relationships, because you're just knocked about all the time. And there's this one. This is my gym glove. I picked this because it's got, I don't know if you tell, the fingertips are missing. It's missing clothes, like a lot of the people at my gym. Okay? Like, I go in, I'm like, it's 20 degrees, what are you wearing? And they're like, I'm looking for attention, leave me alone. Right? So, and they're just sitting there and like, hey, and this is lust here, and this comes in, and it's like the temptress or the temptor for you, right? And so this person's gonna be like, hey, if you're with me, it'd be so much better, right? So you're sitting there and you're gonna make these decisions all the time based on all these, because you're interacting with all of these people here. And then there's just life. I mean, not people, you have these people, and people are always knocking you about. If you don't have the Spirit of God in you, then you're going to sit and get knocked around by other people, and then you're going to respond. And you're going to respond without the instruction of the Holy Spirit, and you're going to respond without the power of the Holy Spirit. And I mentioned life. Life could be chance. Life will just come out of nowhere. It's not even people. It's stuff that's like totally out of your control. And it's like, it's political issues, or it's a health issue. And life is just going to come at you, and you don't have the Spirit of God in you, and it's going to come over and here's some health news, or financial news, or political news, or maybe there's these people in Russia that are acting like morons, or whatever, okay? And you're just getting blown about all the time. And so you know what I watch people do? Because I do this. I've been doing this for a living for like 20 years now. And so what people do is I'm like, I got to get away from these people are bad news. I got to go get around some church people. Show up at church. And life's blown them about, or they've been knocked about. And so they get these people are nice church people here. And so what they do is people say, man, I've been knocked around by life. And I'm going to go and I'm going to come to worship on Sunday. And man, if you receive Jesus Christ, you come to worship on Sunday. Like Jesus said in John 4, God desires worshipers. So you worship, and you get to a Bible study so you can grow in your knowledge, and you go start doing missions, work with other Christians, you get around these other people. And it's like, man, I'm still floppy. And so people go through all of these religious exercises and they do churchy stuff, and you should do that if you're a disciple, but all the while not paying attention to the obvious problem. The obvious problem, this is going to be so anticlimactic for you all. Ready? That's it. That's all I got. Okay. It's the living hand of God. See, the Holy Spirit comes in and indwells people who are spiritually dead. So now what? I've got this person, and I've got the Spirit of God in me, and I can be solid, and they can hit all day long, and it doesn't really matter because I have been given the wisdom of God, I've been given the instruction of God, I've been given the power of God. Okay? Make sense? I can, do I need to do the blower again? Right? I can just, you get the idea. Life can come and blow me about, and not only does God, there's a Spirit then enlighten me, God calls me to something of meaning and purpose and significance. So I brought some tools. Right, to illustrate that, just to drive this home so you remember. Right? God gives me a calling. He says, hey, now that you are on my side in my mission, you have something to do. And so these people can come along and they can tempt and they can provoke, and you're just working, you're building. I brought the hammer to like symbolize you building something good. I also brought some gardening tools to represent sometimes you've got to get the weeds out. Sometimes you're going to be removing bad stuff. That's the work that God's going to be calling you to do in the world, is take care of injustice, like eradicate injustice and evil. I brought this one as a gardening tool just because my kids, I did this for my kids the other day. I was showing them, and they brought this. We can use this one. This is their favorite, one of their favorite toys in the garage, right? The eye gouger. okay? They don't mind playing with this one because they figured out, thank you, Community Medical Center, that if you go to the ER, you get lollipops. They're like, hey, throw this in my face, right? And so that's them. You get the idea? It makes sense, right? So I need the Holy Spirit of God living inside of me. Not just doing churchy stuff, not just going to Bible studies, not just reading my Bible, not just getting knowledge, but actually receiving the same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the grave. That is how things change this side of the grave. That's how things change this side of the grave. So how can I have this Holy Spirit who can enlighten and empower my turnaround? How can I have this Holy Spirit who can enlighten and empower my turnaround? When I go to the book of Acts, there's several ways that I can answer that. I've got several different spots in the Bible, several different parts of the Bible to talk about this. Some places are going to say you have to believe. Okay, some places are going to say that you have to call on the name of the Lord. Some places it's going to say you have to confess with your mouth. We're going to go to one here that's going to talk about, it's going to say repent, be baptized, and you'll see why in a minute. Because my friend Matt, who was in first service, was baptized just a handful of minutes ago, like an hour ago. Really, really cool. Resurrection Sunday, and Matt gets baptized. So I want to talk about why. Because when you look at Acts chapter 2, you see people receive the Holy Spirit. So here we go. Let me give you this setup. Let me give you just a little bit of context. So Jesus sees humanity in their desperate state. He comes. He adds humanity to his divinity. So he's fully God. He's fully human. He lives a perfect life. A perfect life. And he dies on the cross for our sins. And he rises again on the third day. First Easter, almost 2,000 years ago, and then he goes to his disciples. He says, hey, y'all are going to make disciples. All nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all I've commanded. And then he says, hey, I'm going to go to my throne in heaven. I'm going to send my Holy Spirit, the hand and the glove. I'm going to send my Holy Spirit in order to give you power, in order to enliven you. And so that happens in Acts chapter 2. And then this guy, Peter, who is one of Jesus' disciples, he gets up and he starts preaching. Let me tell you who he's preaching to. Right? You are a much nicer looking crowd. Right? You are a kinder, better looking crowd than the one that Peter was preaching to, because the crowd that Peter was preaching to was the group that had Jesus crucified. So there's a lot of you that come in here today like, man, you don't know what I've done. It's true, but you probably didn't kill the Son of God. So whatever you've got going on in your past, I hate to break to you, it's JV. Okay, that was peak. It's junior varsity. So Peter goes and he's preaching to these people who have crucified Jesus. And he's saying, you guys crucified the Messiah. And the Holy Spirit moves and convicts them. So here you go, Acts chapter 2, verse 37 through 38. It says, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. We will sometimes use the word conviction. They were convicted. Like, man, that was God. That was God, and we rejected him, and we had him crucified, and that puts us in very serious judgment and condemnation with God the Father. We rejected his promised Messiah. They were cut to the heart. They don't fly. They weren't like, yeah, but it was just like they owned it. So they're cut to the heart, and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what should we do? And Peter said to them, repent, be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we're looking for. How do I get the hand and the glove? I want to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So I want to talk about a couple of these words that I underlined for you real quick. Repent, be baptized. There's two things. So repentance, or repent as a Bible word. Some people will say it means to make a 180. That's good. That's not bad, right? I'm going to change directions from running away from God to running to God. I'm going to give you two other ways to add to your perspective. The first one is going to be break up. We're going to break up now, okay? And the other one is going to be defection. So let's talk about breakup first. Has anybody had a really bad breakup before? Have you ever had a really, really negative conversation? No, I'm the only one. Okay, right, okay, just one. Okay, it's you and me. So let me tell you about my really bad breakup. It was 2005. I'd finished up school at the University of Florida. I went out to Bible school in Texas. And while I was at Bible school in Texas, I meet this girl who's in the biblical counseling program. So I'm there for preacher school, and she's there for counseling program to kind of like work through some of the stuff that she had done and things that had been done to her. So she's there, and she's studying the thing to help her. So we meet each other. We start hanging out and talking Bible, and, you know, we're just a couple seminary kids, and we're just hanging out in Dallas-Fort Worth area and kind of maybe kind of seeing what's going on. breakup line is this. Here it is. For those of you that need to, like, break up with people, I don't need to do this anymore. But for those of you, this is, like, practical skill life training in church. So here we go. Breakup line says, listen, so I've been thinking about this. And here it is. I feel like you're trying to force something that's not really meant to be. So undefined. Right? It's nothing. I just said nothing. They can't argue. Like, there's no, you can't argue with it. Right? So I try this. Except I figure out, it's February of 2005, and the reason I remember this is because Valentine's Day is coming up, okay? And so I'm sitting here, I'm like, okay, do I break up with her before Valentine's Day or after Valentine's Day? This is a classic question for a lot of people, like, Christmas is coming up, man, Valentine's Day is coming up, man, and her mother's birthday is coming up, right? And she got this kind of thing, like, should I do wait? You've been in this situation before. I decide to wait, okay? This is the wrong choice. Find out. We go do Valentine's Day. It's early in the week that year. I don't remember if it's Monday or Tuesday or whatever, but we just like Thursday or Friday. And we go out and we've got food and we're going back to her house to her apartment to watch a movie or something. And I sit down to have the breakup conversation. I'm going to break up with her. And so I'm like, this is going to be great because what I'm expecting is this is such a great breakup line. What I want and what everybody wants in a breakup situation is that you go, yeah, I think so too. Fist bump, woo, and then we're out. That's what you want. That's not what happened. Okay? Because I fire off my line. Hey, I really feel like we're trying to force something that's not meant to be. And she changed in that moment into a demon. Right? And there's this erratic breathing and there's saliva, okay? Like just flying out. And so we got to get into this conversation, and I can't exactly remember what all had happened, but she pieced together that I wanted to break up with her before Valentine's Day, but was faking it on Valentine's Day, which was apparently even way more offensive than just breaking up with her. So the dishonesty and disingenuous nature, I thought it was compassion. It was not received as compassion. It was not good. And so there's all this fire breathing, and so she gets up. We're on her couch or at her dining room table or whatever. She gets up and walks in her room and closes the door, slams the door, but closes the door. And I'm sitting there because she left like mid-conversation, and I'm like, she's quiet like this. I'm like, what do I do? Do I leave? And I'm sitting there. It's Texas, and I know her family. She's born into a family of Republicans. Okay, so I'm thinking I'm about to get shot. Right, that's what's good, because if you know, like, I know Montana's like guns and everything, but down in Texas, they don't even have to wear clothes because they're so warm and up that everything's covered, right? They just ching, they're walking along, they have spurs and tennis shoes. Anyway, so if you've never been to Texas, that's literally what it's like. So I'm concerned that I'm going to get shot. She comes back out, and she's, like, foaming at the mouth, mad. And so she comes out, and she's, I remember the last line, the last words were, one day you're going to wake up and realize what you walked away from. It was that. So anyway, I'm like, you know, should I go? I should probably go. I don't remember how it went after that, but I left. And right around the corner from her apartment was this gas station that I would go to fill up my truck. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm filling up my truck, and I'm like, some of you need to have a breakup with the beliefs and behaviors that have created despair and misery and mediocrity. Disillusionment and desperation in your life. And you're terrified to turn to Christ because you're concerned that the breakup is going to be big and scary and nasty. But what you get when you come to Christ is you get to stand at the gas pump and go, the weight is off. It's over. So repentance means turning away from the evil. Right? So that's an incredible, beautiful thing. And then I want to talk about the idea of defection. Okay, so repenting. When we repent, the other thing that I want to talk about is it's a 180, it's a breakup, sometimes it's a defection. And I'll tell you a story, and in my illustration, the Russians are going to be the bad guys, and the Americans are going to be the good guys. So, you wake up one day, and you're a KGB agent. You're a KGB spy. And what you do is you wake up, and you go, and you kill Americans, right? You hide in the closet, you steal the microfiche, and you hang from the wire from the ceiling, or whatever that you do in the KGB, and you're just a bad guy, and you're working against the Americans, you've been killing them, and trying to get them ready to receive nuclear war, whatever it is that you're doing as a Russian KGB agent. And one day you're like, I don't want to be this anymore. And I wake up. I wake up to the reality of who I am. And so what you decide to do as a Russian KGB agent is you're going to turn yourself in. You're going to defect. And so you're going to go over to the U.S. Embassy. So just imagine you're going to a U.S. Embassy
somewhere in Russia, and right, you have the Marines there, and you got tanks and missiles and flags and the whole embassy thing, and you go, hands up, and surrender and say, hey, I'm here to turn myself in. I've been fighting against you guys. Now, at that moment, they can totally kill you. But they don't. And that's called mercy. You say, hey, I'm here to defect. I'm here to join your side. And so they say, hey, if you pledge allegiance and if you defect from Russia, the kingdom of darkness, and you come and you join our side, you pledge allegiance to us, we're not just going to show you mercy. We're actually going to lavish you with grace. We're going to give you a home in the United States of America, and salary and health care. We're going to take care of you. You become a citizen of our country, and we're going to take good care of you. That is a picture of repentance and what happens when we repent and pledge allegiance to Jesus Christ. The book of Colossians calls life apart from Christ the kingdom of darkness, and Jesus is calling all of us to turn away from being those KGB agents, to have the break up, to go and say, hey, I am here to pledge allegiance to you. And that's where you get this word baptism. I've got a lot of passages on baptism, but one of my favorite on this is 1 Peter 3:21, because it's a pledge that appeals. It's a pledge of allegiance. So I want to show you a video, because Matt was baptized here this last service. And Matt has gone to church for a while. He grew up with a church background. He's been in church circles for a long time, but he came to the terms with the reality that he was kind of keeping Jesus at arm's length. He was just indifferent towards Jesus, or maybe just amicable. Maybe he would frame it like this. We had a long talk yesterday about this whole thing. He would say, hey, I was a fan, but I wasn't a follower. And so Matt was just baptized an hour ago. We videoed it to show you all. If you're new here, this is a big celebration, exciting thing for us. So I know it's a video. He's not here. He can't hear you. But the Bible says that when one sinner repents and turns back to God, that there's a celebration in heaven. And so everybody that's been here before knows how we handle baptisms. It's not like super somber. It's big celebration, so you can get crazy loud. But check out Matt here being baptized and pledging allegiance to Jesus Christ.
So here's the deal. So those of you that are new here, we bought this building. It's an old building. They told us if we set up our baptistry upstairs, then it would end up downstairs. So we really value efficiency, so we just skipped that step and put it downstairs anyway. So that's why we're doing it this way. So here's the deal. If you are new here, you got to hear how we do this. This is a celebration, Luke 15. God says that heaven celebrates when one sinner repents and pledges allegiance to Jesus Christ. It's a big celebration. So I'm going to ask Matt two questions. He and I had a conversation yesterday morning. I'm going to ask him two questions, and then I'm going to baptize him. When that happens, I want you to just go absolutely crazy up there, all right? Like a big celebration. Ready? So you ready?
I'm ready.
So exciting. And Matt, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who came to earth, lived a perfect life, died on the cross for your sins, rose again on the third day, and now is risen and reigning King?
Yes, I do.
Amen. Man, because of what you said, because of that, you commit, follow him all the rest of your days, regardless of the cost you.
To yourself.
For sure. For sure. I like it. Then go ahead. All you gotta do that, then, because of what you said, your name, man, I'm gonna baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. For forgiveness of sins.
It's really cool to see that happen with Matt. It's happened with so many folks through the ministry of One Missoula Church. I have a question for you. I told you that I really sincerely hope that in 5 years you can look back on Easter 2023 and say that's when a pivot happened. I told you my prayer, my desire is that, man, maybe you hear things in a way that you haven't heard them before. You see things in a way that you haven't seen them before. And then the lights just come on. Right? And you realize, like, I'm that glove that's getting knocked around by people and life and the world. When power and strength and enlightenment, the Spirit of God is offered to me through Jesus Christ. My question for you is this. Do you find yourself in a desperate situation? Do you find yourself disillusioned or despairing today? Because if so, there is hope in Jesus Christ. Have you received Jesus Christ, right? Rather than just coming to an Easter service, have you received Jesus Christ? And if not, my prayer is that you would not settle for anything less. I'm going to stop talking here in just a second. Those who are Christians who have pledged allegiance to Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you to get elements for communion, bring them back to your seats. For those that are not, my question for you is this. Think. Even pray. I dare you to pray. I challenge you to pray. Ask God to give you the eyes to see and ears to hear the beautiful things that He is offering to you, is calling to you. Ask God, I dare those of you that are investigating the claims of Christ and have not pledged allegiance to Him.
stop talking here. Christians, go get the elements. The rest of you can spend some time in reflection and prayer on this Easter Sunday. And then Michael is going to come up and walk us through communion. Let me pray for us. Father God, I thank you so much for the resurrection, for Easter Sunday and everything it represents. Jesus, when things are dark, when they're bleak, when they're desperate, you have given us hope. Lord, we love you. We give you all the praise on this Easter day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys take